This is the Detroit Sports Podcast Network.
The winds of change are blowing for the Detroit Lions. We're going to talk about some of the recent departures of Joique Bell, Steven Tulloch. I have a surprise cut that may end up happening. It's do or die time for Matt Stafford. We have to discuss some of the implications on that. And we have a treat. Nolan Vasan from NFL Draft Geek is joining us just in time for the combine. So stay right here on the Hindsight 20. Welcome to the Hindsight 20 podcast. I am your host, Jerry Mallory. I want to thank each and every one of you for listening. As always, a proud member of the Detroit Sports Podcast Network. It's where I can be found. Doc and Jock, Tigers Talk, Fantasy Geek, one-on-one, you name it. If you like Detroit sports, if you like sports in general, you've come to the right place. DetroitSportsPodcast.com. Subscribe on iTunes. If you got Android, go to Podbay and hook it up. Let's get right into this show. Like I said, we have a treat for you guys. Nolan Vasan from NFL Draft Geek was able to join us. So he's going to be talking about the Lions, the draft in general. You know, this thing is it's right around the corner. You know, you've got the combine and things are about to take off. And so we're going to go ahead and listen to the interview that we did with him right before the break. But we must talk about some of the guys that are no longer here with the Detroit Lions. Parting ways with both Joique Bell and Steven Tulloch, CJ Wilson too, but most notably, Joique Bell and Steven Tulloch. So first off, you know, you got to give credit and you got to give props to the contributions that both of these men had for Detroit. Now, Joique Bell, we know the story, and you know, as much as you love the story, you heard it so much, it was kind of like, okay, guys, we know Wayne State. You know, oh, he played at the school. He can walk from Ford Field. Like, we get it. Security guard, practice squad here, practice squad there, finding his way back to Detroit and having some really productive years for the Lions. And the cool thing of it is, you know, when you're talking about some of these guys, and now we can sprinkle a playoff berth here or there, or instrumental in some winning seasons, both of these guys around for at least one, in Steven Tulloch's case, two, playoff runs. And that's something that, you know, previous to 2010, like from about 2000 2010, any guy that kind of came and went in that span, no playoffs to talk about. So it's cool that when we're talking about the history of guys that have been on the team and have had some key contributions on the last few years, we can talk about, yeah, the 11-5 season, Tulloch being a part of the 10-6 run, and then the one of the best defense that the Lions have had ever. And so for Joique Bell's sake, you know, we appreciate the contributions. Now, from all accounts, he was offered a pay cut, at which point he turned down. And so he's gambling on himself, saying, hey, I've enjoyed my time here in Detroit, but I've got to do what's best for my family. And I'm willing to say and bet that I can make more money on the open market. And that's what he's going to go for. Can't fault him for that at all, but I'm not faulting the Lions either. Now, the thing with him and with Tulloch, you're starting to hear people say, oh man, you know, cutting these guys and this and that, you know, what he's meant for Detroit and Detroit versus everybody. I get that. A few things you have to keep in mind. First and foremost, you've got a new guy here. So he really has no connection or affiliation with any of them. He doesn't have I was at Steven Tulloch's doorstep, you know, at midnight when free agency started. No, that was the old regime. That was Martin Mayhew and Jim Schwartz. You know, the rumor is they were right there, right after midnight, you know, ready to sign Kyle Vandenbosch and Steven Tulloch. He doesn't have that connection with them. He has a business to run. And let's face it, Joique Bell, who did look better toward the end of the year, still struggled. You know, the explosion just was not there. The Achilles was probably the culprit. You know, whatever the reason was, this is the guy. You flash forward or you rewind, excuse me, to last week's podcast. And I said it was a prediction that Joique Bell would be one of the people that would get cut. You look at the money that you save, and you look at the implications from that standpoint, and it's a business move. Okay, your heart wants to say yes, Joy. You know, you want all these guys that you love and root for to be around if there is a big turnaround. But, you know, if a lot of them are here, you know, guys on the wrong side of 30 or, you know, older and aging, you probably won't be able to see that turnaround in the first place. Same with Steven Tulloch. You know, he signed two contracts with us, and you appreciate his contributions. But you look at the play last year, and it was bad, man. It's particularly when he had to play in space. He's on the wrong side of 30 with an ACL, and he was due to make some good money, so they saved millions of dollars by cutting him. It's a business decision. You appreciate the leadership that Steven Tulloch brought. He was durable up until a point, and you can always count on him for 100-plus tackles, stout against the run, never hearing of issues with him. He seemed like one of those guys the coaches love. He seemed like one of those guys that just, you know, always there and ready and willing to provide for the team. But like I said, you got to cut bait with guys. Same with James Ahedebo. He's a free agent. He tried to get that big money last year, and I don't blame him because, you know, he had a career year in 2014. And so he's like, hey, I want this extension. I'm so glad Martin Mayhew kind of saw past that. You know, Martin Mayhew wasn't all bad, guys. You know, we could be looking at James Ahedebo with an extra 2 or 3 years on his contract. No, they said, well, yeah, you had one good year, but you're signed on for one more. You know, he threatened holding out, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not killing him for that. But, you know, all indications point to his services not being needed any longer for the Detroit Lions, so he won't be back. Then you had Rasheen Mathis, who retired. You know, ageless wonder to some extent. You know, you bring him in. He was going to come in for a veteran presence and, you know, compete. And he ended up being for a couple of seasons the best cornerback on our team until Darius Slay was ready to take that reign. It seems as though his impact off the field was pretty big too. And we got a lot of young guys, okay? Alex Carter, Nevin Lawson, Quandre Diggs, Issa Abdul-Kaddous, Darius Slay. This is a young nucleus of defensive backs, all who have in the last few days come out and said how much they appreciated what Rasheen Mathis taught them, how he trained, how he lived, how he led by example, you know, and so you got to appreciate what he's done. You know, he's getting a little older. He has some concussion issues. So it all kind of lined up for him saying, hey, we're going to go ahead and move on, next chapter of my career. And so a lot of these guys are, you know, they're gone, man. It's some changes. The defense is going to see a lot of changes. Now, last year, it was kind of forced upon us, losing Sue, Levy with the injury. You know, you're kind of gaining a guy with Levy this upcoming year. A lot of reports talking about, you know, maybe only 4 returning guys on defense. There'll be some re-signings. If I'm giving predictions, I think Issa Abdul-Kaddous comes back and will be a guy that will compete for a starting safety. I'd be comfortable with him there too, right alongside Glover Quinn. Teron Walker or Haloti Ngata should come back, one of those two. And linebacker, you know, I want to hear Whitehead to come back, but it all depends. You know, will the market kind of force us to say, yeah, we're going to move on? And so it should be interesting to see. But kudos to Joique Bell, bringing Naughty by Nature and Hey Ho back to the forefront with the hay in the hole when he scored the touchdown, the Detroit versus everybody, the Wayne State connection. I was going to Wayne State same time as him, even had a class with him. You know, really solid guy. You appreciate what he brought as well as Steven Tulloch. But, hey, it's a business. These guys are a little bit older. You know, we want to get younger, faster, better. They don't quite fit that mode. And you save some money. So who's next? Who's another guy or two that will be on that chopping block? Well, if I'm looking at this thing, you know, I'm looking at your Jason Joneses and your Brandon Pettigrew, you know, and I got a surprise one I'm going to talk about, but we'll save that till after the break. Okay, Nolan Vassan, NFL Draft Geek. We had a lot to talk about, talking about not just the Lions, who he has going to the Lions at 16, talked about some sleepers, and a whole lot more pertaining to the NFL draft. So let's give a listen as Nolan Vassan breaks down the NFL draft. All right, guys, as promised, we've got Nolan Vassan from NFL Draft Geek joining us on the show today. Nolan, what's going on, man?
Very, not too much, man. We're getting into draft season. I thank you for having me on.
Man, this has to be like this is winning time for you, man. It has to be crazy for you right now. What's going on over on your website before we inundate you with Lions questions?
Yeah, man, just right after the Super Bowl, everybody gets over missing football for about 2-3 weeks. After the Super Bowl's over, then it's like, we got to get back into football, and then it becomes draft season. So the Combine comes around. Combine's coming up next week. And then after that, it really just gets into full-on craziness, mock drafts and all that stuff. So up at NFL Draft Geek, we're updating our 3-round mock draft tomorrow. You can create your own mock draft. And we're also writing for USA Today Sports Weekly. So there's a lot of good stuff. It's all free. So come check us out.
Yeah, man. It's a really good website. I am a draft junkie. You know, I'm not as knowledgeable as guys like you or some of the other people I like to follow.
No.
But I'm as big a fan of it. I just don't have the knowledge. So I'm always on different websites. Yours is
because it's all positivity around draft time. There's no negativity. It's all positive. When the games come, you know, reality hits. But when it's draft, it's all potential.
There you go, man. It's like hope springs eternal. So, yeah, definitely, guys. Check out NFL Draft Geek. .com is one of the best for all your draft needs. So let's get into this thing. As you mentioned, you've got a 3-round mock. You've got a new one coming out tomorrow. This show releases the same day, Monday. So they'll be listening to this once you have your new one out. Tell us about who you have going at number 16 for the Detroit Lions and why.
Right. So it will be Reggie Ragland, linebacker, Alabama. So for the last few mock drafts, we've had him with either a defensive lineman. There's a lot of good defensive tackles in this draft. And depending on who's available, there could be some good pass rushers available because we know it would be ideal to get another stud opposite Ziggy Ansah. And then the interior line is a little bit up in the air with Nada being a free agent, Tyron Walker and all that. So we're just not quite sure what's going to happen.
Right.
But with the release of Steven Tulloch, that kind of really makes it obvious because we were already kind of tossed up. Do we go defensive line? Do we go linebacker? Because you got Reggie Ragland and our boy Jalen Smith, the Notre Dame injured linebacker, still available. But with Tulloch being cut, you know, that really leaves a weakness, not just in the way of talent, but also leadership. You don't really want to go without having a leader at middle linebacker, somebody who can captain the defense and make sure everybody's in the proper position. And that's what Reggie Ragland can do as a middle linebacker. He's a leader. He makes his teammates better. He's a complete 3-down player who can stay on the field for all 3 downs, run and pass. And if available at 16, I think he'd be an excellent value for the Lions and be someone who can make a day-one impact.
I'm going to tell you this much. I think the people at Pride Detroit, who I know a lot of the guys listen, and the people here at the Detroit Sports Podcast Network, they love to hear that. We've been on the Reggie Ragland hype train for quite some time. Like you said, with Steven Tulloch being gone, it makes a ton of sense. So this is the funny thing, Nolan, and I know you noticed this because if you being in-depth with these players, you know, people's stock, they tend to fluctuate so much between the end of the college football season and then, like, right around the combine. Although they have played no games, you know, you've got the Senior Bowl and then the Shrine, East-West Shrine. But in terms of, like, you know, NCAA games, there is no games. The combine hasn't even happened yet. But guys' stocks, they fall and they rise. Give me a couple of players whose stock since the end of the NCAA year has risen the most and whose stock has dropped the most since college football ended like a month and a half ago at this point.
Yeah, I know. It seems like forever. But the one guy who rose the most is definitely got to be Carson Wentz, the kid out of North Dakota State.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's been getting hype all year. It's not like he just came out of nowhere that everybody's talking about him as a top 5, top 10 pick. But you just have your questions about him coming out of Division II. You're not quite sure. But then when he came to the Senior Bowl and what he did at the Senior Bowl playing against top competition, you get to actually see him with your eyes, see him in pads, see him interact, because you can only learn so much watching a guy on TV, because there's not that many people who went to go see North Dakota State games. There's just not. But now he comes down to Mobile, all eyes on him, and he goes and shows out to the highest level. He didn't just have a good week. He was outstanding. Arm strength, as good as advertised. Size, as good as advertised. Leadership, we didn't know what to expect, and it was better than advertised. A lot of times with these small school guys, you get a lot of hype. Everybody talks them up. You know, oh, you haven't heard of this guy. And then you see him in person, and, you know, they just don't quite live up to the billing. But Carson Wentz absolutely did, even off the field, handle himself very, very well. So he's definitely moved himself to being either the first or second best quarterback in the draft with Jared Goff out of Cal. I still like Jared Goff better, but a lot of mock drafts have him being the first quarterback, which could put him potentially as high as number two to Cleveland. And that's a guy coming out of Division II, which could be the number two overall pick in the draft, potentially even number one if somebody wants to trade ahead of Cleveland to get a quarterback. And the guy who's falling the most would be Robert Kimdichie out of Ole Miss, who actually may be the most talented player in this draft, just pound for pound. You're talking about athleticism, talent, potential. He's everything. He's a unique defensive lineman. He's basically a 310-pound pass rusher who's just overgrown his position and never lost any of his athleticism. But he got suspended. He had that incident falling out of a window, smoking synthetic marijuana.
That was crazy, man.
Issues. So there's a lot of red flags with him. Talent is there, but the more digging you do, it looks like he might be a little bit of a problem child. So talent is there, but his off-field is really pushing him down the board.
Yeah, I saw Kimdichie, you know, on a couple of mocks, like during the college football season, before the season began, like number one, number two, mm-hmm. You know, like you said, the talent is there. And then Wentz, it's funny, man, you know, the sexy position or pick for him now I'm seeing is with Dallas at number four. That's how much his stock has gone up. So it should be interesting. Now, with the combine coming up this week, we're going to see a lot of guys who could potentially increase their stock value. I think about athletic freaks, man. Vernon Davis comes to mind, someone that really wowed people at the combine. Vic Beasley last year, you know, the size and the speed, the athleticism. Who are you expecting to shine at this upcoming combine, Nolan?
Jalen Ramsey, Florida State, cornerback / safety. He's fun to watch because he's actually somebody who's a potential Olympian next summer. He is the ACC's top long jumper, champion in long jump, and nationals, NCAA nationals, he plays four. So he's actually a guy who has stated he has hopes of participating in next summer's Olympics. But for right now, he's a consensus All-American who is projected to be a top five pick in pretty much every mock draft you look at. 2 years ago, he started every year of his 3 years at Florida State. For the first 2 years, he played safety, kind of like a nickelback, like a Tyrann Mathieu.
Right.
But at 6'2", he's a heavy hitter. Last year, they moved him to full-time cornerback. He plays on the boundary and does nearly just as good. Teams don't throw at him, so you didn't get to see him as much. But the athleticism is there. So basically, you've got a 6'2" cornerback who can play safety, middle of the field, Olympic-style athlete. He's somebody who can just, not only in the 40, but in every drill, just kind of just blow you off the charts. So that's somebody that we're really looking at.
Yeah, I like him a lot. When the Lions were free falling in the first half of the season at 1-7, you know, I'm like, okay, if we end up with the first pick, you know, even Stafford's replacement was up in the air, but then Laremy Tunsil, you win a game or two, but you're still kind of like in that top five area. Jalen Ramsey was certainly someone I was thinking, hey, this guy could be a real good fit for the Detroit Lions. Now, everyone isn't going to pop at the combine. You know, some guys have good measurables, but they can't translate it to the field. And then conversely, some guys don't have the best measurables, but, you know, they actually are good football players. Give me a name or two. Someone that you are expecting to kind of have a disappointing combine. They won't have gaudy numbers, but will flourish once game time arrives.
Yeah, it's always interesting, and I happen to think the combine is pretty overrated. I mean, just recently we've seen numbers like DeAndre Hopkins, all-pro receiver, runs 4.57 at the combine. Jarvis Landry out of Miami ran like 4.6, something like that. So you really don't want to read too much into that. I think a wide receiver position is a big one of the most positions where that'll happen, because you kind of think of it as a position where you need a lot of speed. But when it comes down to it, you saw about it's a lot of his running routes, catching the football, making contested catches. And I think one guy who you might put in that category is Josh Doctson out of TCU. He's just not going to run a fast 40. I'd be surprised if he ran in the 4.4s. He's one of the most productive receivers in college football last year. Smooth athlete, catches the ball, sharp route runner, but the speed he's not going to wow you. So I could see him being that type of receiver, like a Jarvis Landry, who doesn't really do that well at the combine, but comes out and is just a producer. Same thing with maybe like Derrick Henry, running back. He's 245 pounds. You know, he's not going to go out there and tear it up on the track. but you put him in pads, and ain't nobody out there who wants to tackle him. So I just caution everybody, don't put too much stock into what happens in these 40-yard dash numbers.
All right, cool, man. Yeah, it can always I don't know, it can always backfire, you know, for every guy that has those huge numbers, but, you know, they don't produce. You know, I always wonder why people put so much stock into the combine. It's a good indicator, but like you said, sometimes it can be overrated. Now, we're talking about Carson Wentz, and you've got him going in the teens. I haven't seen him outside of the top 10 from too many people lately. I've seen him as high as 2-4. A lot of people, you know, San Francisco potentially. Are you not as convinced on him as others? Or are you kind of waiting to see a little bit more information before you are willing to say, hey, this guy might even be the first quarterback taken in the draft?
No, it's not that. It's just team needs, how the mock draft goes. We have him as our number 4 overall player, Carson Wentz. But it's just kind of interesting the way this sets up. Like, you look at the top of the draft, Titans, obviously they don't need a quarterback. They got Mariota.
Right.
Chargers, they just re-signed Rivers. Jaguars, they got Bortles. Ravens, they're set. The two kind of wild cards you're looking at there is, like you already mentioned, the Cowboys. They got Romo, but at 34 years old, you know, you're not, I don't think he's at the point where you want to replace him. He's probably at the point where you want to supplement him with talent and try to get the best out of his later years. That's just my take on it. And then the other wild card would be 7 with the 49ers. They bring in Chip Kelly. You know, what does that mean for Colin Kaepernick? There are some people who still believe in Blaine Gabbert. So you've got those two guys there. Maybe they figure one of them will pan out. That wouldn't be my take. I would take Wentz if I was them. But after that, you go down the board, you got Tannehill, you got Jameis Winston, Eli Manning, Drew Brees, and Jay Cutler before the Eagles pick at 13. So it's just the way it's shaping up now. More than likely, if Wentz were to start falling past 6, 7, 8, somebody would trade up, like the Rams or the Texans, and take him. But we're just not at the point in our mock draft where we want to start projecting trades and blowing everything up like that. But he's the number 4 overall player on our board. Could easily be the number 2 overall pick, and I don't see any way that he falls out of the top 10 on draft day.
There you go, man. It's amazing. A guy from such a small school is now in consideration for that high of a pick. And if it was, like you said, if it wasn't for Mariota, this guy would be potentially in the running for the number 1 overall pick. Just astonishing.
Yeah. Now, you know what's funny is the only scholarship offer from D1 he received coming out of high school was from Central Michigan.
Oh, wow.
nobody else.
It kind of shows, man. You know, a lot of these guys, you know, J.J. Watt is one that comes to mind. You know, people develop at later stages in their early life, and some people are scouts just miss the ball on a few guys. Now, I'm such a degenerate when it comes to this whole draft thing that I've started looking at some 2017 mock drafts. I looked at you guys a couple other places, and I mean it's no surprise who a lot of people have at number 1, Clemson quarterback Watson. I mean, what I want to know from you is, if he was in this year's draft, where would he rank amongst them? Would he be the first quarterback taken? Would he be definitely, you know, the number 2 pick, or even people trying to trade into number 1? You know, how much hype, you know, was actually worthy in terms of where you think he would fall in this year's draft?
He's number 1, no doubt. No doubt about it. Well, number 1 player in the draft. Titans hold the number 1 pick. They wouldn't take him, obviously. But the Titans, actually, this year, they're hoping that there's going to be a market like that, but it's just not shaping up like that. Because
right.
Jared Goff and Carson Wentz, they're very good. They franchise quarterbacks, but they're not Deshaun Watson. And Deshaun Watson, it's just almost everything you want out of a franchise quarterback. He's got the size, he's got the arm strength, the athleticism, the leadership, mental makeup, and he's a winner. The thing that kind of scares you, especially with Carson Wentz, you can only be so certain about a guy who's played in Division II.
That's true.
I mean, you're jumping 2 levels. You're not just jumping from Division I to the NFL. You're jumping 2 levels. Jared Goff, he's not perfect either. He's had his struggles at Cal, thrown some interceptions at times. Didn't win a whole lot of football games. Not that that was his fault, but it's just saying that Deshaun Watson is on a whole nother plateau. He's on the next level, mentally ready to go. So he would definitely be the number 1 player on the board. The Browns would no doubt take him at 2. There wouldn't be a discussion whether it's Goff, Wentz, or Deshaun Watson. It's Deshaun Watson and then everybody else. So Unfortunately, the NFL won't let him enter the draft early. Maybe that's something I still hope they'll change down the line. But next year, barring anything completely unforeseen, he's the slam dunk number one in 2017.
I got to start thinking of some clever ways or names when teams start tanking for him. I don't know what, maybe flopping for Watson.
Weak for Watson,
yeah,
I don't know.
You know, we'll come up with something. But, yeah, I'm with you there. I think he's one of the guys that may live up to the hype. Now, let's close this thing out, getting back to who the people have dialed into this podcast to hear about the Detroit Lions. We talked about number 16 first round, Reggie Ragland. That makes a ton of sense. We're hoping now, you know, with Bob Quinn, that it's not all about the first pick or the second pick, because, you know, teams win by finding those diamonds in the rough, finding sleeper picks. Give me a sleeper or two, even if it's in the second round, a second round and beyond, a sleeper or two that may be a good fit for the Detroit Lions.
I think it's going to be on the defensive line, because a part of the reason that we changed to Reggie Ragland in the first round is because you can get depth at defensive line in this year's draft. It's the strongest position. Let me list off a couple guys. Chris Jones, Mississippi State. Malik Collins, Nebraska. Jihad Ward, Illinois. Those are two interior linemen who I think could perfectly fit what the Lions are looking for, whether if it's at defensive tackle or even some guys who can give you a little combo and play outside on the edge. The depth in this year's draft is really on the defensive line and defensive tackles. Also, cornerback. I'll give you some small school guys who really impressed me at the Senior Bowl. Harlan Miller, Southeastern Louisiana. James Bradbury, Sanford. DeAndre Hall, Northern Iowa. So you can read up about those guys on our site. I'm not going to get that nerdy on you. But the thing that we like about these guys is the size. The long cornerback that Seattle made popular, it's really starting to come into play with the way cornerbacks are developing. So if you want to get a big cornerback to kind of replace Rasheem Mathis and play opposite Darius Slay, there's some guys you can get in the third, fourth round with some size and physicality who can really be nice cornerbacks for you.
All right, cool, man. I'm going to be looking out for those names. Hey, Nolan, this has been great. Let's make this a recurring thing. Don't be a stranger. I know you got so much coverage and things you're doing, so we won't pester you every week. But, you know, in the next month or so, we'd love to get you back on here. Again, let everybody know what's going on at your site, NFLDraftGeek.com.
Man, I appreciate you having me. Anything for a fellow Detroiter. So, it's nothing special. NFL Draft Geek on Twitter, NFLDraftGeek.com. We give you everything we need. We try to do as little advertisements as possible. We try to give you some actual insight, give us our actual opinion, not just something that's been regurgitated from Mel Kiper or Todd McShay or whatnot. So our rankings and stuff are going to be a little different. And then also we love for you to go on there, and if you think our mock draft is crap, go make your own mock draft machine. You can make one just for the Lions, 7-round mock draft just for the Lions. You can make a 7-rounder if you want to try that, or just give us your first-round mock draft. Other people can grade it and comment on it. We have a nice little community there. So check out NFL Draft Geek as we move along.
All right, man. As always, like I said, Nolan, I want to thank you for being on the show. We're looking forward to having you back on in the future, bro.
Not a problem. Thank you so much for having me, Jerry.
All right. Once again, we want to thank Nolan Fasan for joining us. Detroit. I keep on wanting to put them on Detroit websites. It's funny, when I first got them on the show, I wanted to say Detroit Draft Central or something like that. Nolan Vasan, NFLDraftGeek.com. He's a Detroiter, so I'm keeping, you know, I keep wanting to put him in the mix as a Detroit Draft-centric guy. He's an NFL guy all around, but certainly being from Detroit, he gave us some good insight. Reggie Ragland, you can't fault him for that, man. You know, the Senior Bowl, people kind of, you know, said that Reggie Ragland's shine or his luster kind of fell off a little bit. But, hey, look at the game film. Look at what he did at Alabama. I think a linebacker, I think defense, you know, you just can't go wrong. And I do agree with there being so much depth at the defensive tackle spot. You know, you can wait to the second, third, or even later to get one. Perhaps you want to attack one of the positions, because tons of need, not just defensive tackle. But we could be in the market for an end, certainly a linebacker or two. So once again, we're hoping that this is a recurring thing. We can have him on in another couple of episodes. I won't bother him every week, but he certainly is insightful. He has a lot to talk about. He's knowledgeable on the thing. And being from Detroit, you know, he's talking about the whole NFL, but I'm sure he has a little star every time he's breaking down the draft needs for our boys in Honolulu Blue and Silver. All right, guys, we're going to take a break. When we come back, I'm going to talk about that surprise cut potential person. I mean, I was right about Joik Bell last week. Could this guy be the next person to fall victim of the Jerry prediction? Matt Stafford, it's time to put up or shut up, like I said. I will give you my spiel on that and a whole lot more, so stay tuned on the Hindsight 20. Jerry Mallory here for the Hindsight 20. It's simple. Your ad can be placed right here. Hindsight20podcast@gmail.com. If you want your ad to be placed on this show, if you want to do some business with the Detroit Sports Podcast Network as a whole, send me an email. Let's set something up. We can make it happen. We're back on the Hindsight 20. That was Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. You know, they say once you hit your 30s, you start getting all nostalgic, you know? You start thinking about the things that when you were a kid, you enjoyed. And, hey, Power Rangers definitely one for me, man. I couldn't wait to get home from school, you know? I think they came on at like 4 o'clock, and it was always a cool thing. Now that I'm talking about, I haven't planned on mentioning this, but I'll go ahead. One of my biggest regrets in school. So here's a scenario. All right. It's story time. We haven't had one of these in a couple of episodes. So I hope you got your Swiss Miss with marshmallows or your cup of tea, coffee. Yeah. You're sitting somewhere cozy and warm. It's Jerry Mallory story time. So like I said, I was a huge fan of several different shows. I would say my number one and number two were Power Rangers and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, okay? Those two were tops for me. And so Power Rangers being up there, young Jerry Mallory at middle school, McCullough Elementary in Detroit, Michigan. Well, Jerry Mallory didn't just want to watch the Power Rangers. He wanted to be a Power Ranger. So you'd catch me in the cafeteria practicing some of my karate moves, you know, saying, it's morphin' time, doing this, doing that, and the other thing. Well, one day, one of the lunch ladies noticing me and my buddy always talking about Power Rangers, always, you know, saying something pertaining to them. She says, hey, one of the Power Rangers is he's going to be my son-in-law, the Black Ranger, Zach. Me and him, my buddy looked at her and we just start laughing. Okay, yeah, you know, it was so funny. Like, okay, yeah, a lunch lady, you're potentially going to be the mother-in-law of Zach, the Black Power Ranger. No, it's not possible. She said, no, seriously. Yeah, he's dating my daughter, and they're going to get married in a little while. And yeah, you know, we didn't believe her. She said, I'm going to bring in pictures one day. So a couple weeks pass. We're not thinking about it. She calls us over. She shows us, sure enough, it's the lunch lady. I don't even remember her name. We'll call her Lunch Lady Smith. It's Lunch Lady Smith, and there's several pictures of her with the Black Power Ranger. We're like, wait a minute. No. Especially when you're young. You know, you think these people are larger than life. Hey, he can't be related to anybody that I would possibly know. Well, it doesn't work like that. We know how things are in the real world when you get older with celebrities. Hey, they know people too. They're just people. So we're floored by it. She says, you know what? I'm going to have him come up to the school. You guys are such big fans. Just wait. I'm going to set it up when he's back in town. I believe he was actually from Detroit. When he's back in town, I'm going to have him come up to the school and, you know, have him do like a little ceremony or something. And I'll make sure you guys meet him. You want to talk about excited? I was doing backflips. Literally, back then I could do backflips. So I'm in the playground flipping and I'm extra kicking and I'm getting my Mighty Morphin Power Rangers on big time at that point. So it's all set up. She said, hey, on this day, let's call it a Friday. I don't remember the exact day. She said, hey, Friday, he's coming to the school. You know, she coordinated with our teachers. So we would be one of the classrooms that would be in the auditorium where the Black Ranger would be there at McCullough Elementary. I mean, this is amazing. I don't remember exactly how I got in trouble. There could have been a number of ways because I was a little bit of a class clown, and I definitely liked to practice my wrestling moves and my karate moves, and I wanted to be an NFL. I wanted to be Jerry Rice, so maybe I tackled somebody. Needless to say, Jerry Mallory gets suspended from school for 2 days, Thursday and, yes, the Friday. I promise you guys, this story is 1,000% true. When I give you story time, you know, you want to entertain, but if I don't have anything that's to give you, I'll be quiet. But this is 100% true. So that Thursday, that Friday, I am suspended from school. Monday, I get back, and I'm at lunch, and she, Gerald, where were you? You know, I'm kind of, I don't even, you know, if I had the heart to tell her I got kicked out. I just said I couldn't make it, whatever. She said, hey, I called, you know, I called him. He came, you know, he was on the stage. He was doing flips and kicks, and he called you. He said, you know, Gerald and Sean Taylor, my buddy Sean Taylor, he called you guys to the stage. And since you weren't there, someone else had to take your place. And, you know, he gave them a T-shirt and this and that. It's one of my biggest regrets as a kid. I've got one, too, where I got in trouble and I ended up missing Grant Hill versus Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan's return to basketball against Grant Hill. And because being on punishment, I was not able to watch that game. My mother was kind enough to let me listen to it on the radio. But, yeah, you know, so young ones out there, just be good. You never know. Whoever the equivalent of the Black Power Ranger is, I don't know who that equivalent is in today's society, but whoever that person is, they could come to your school. And if you keep doing good, don't be like a young Jerry Mallory, because you'll get kicked out and you won't be able to see someone and you'll be talking about it 20 years later as one of your biggest regrets as a young child. So, hey, be good. Do the right thing. Don't be like a young Jerry Mallory, and you will get to see the 2016 version of Zach the Black Power Ranger. All right, enough of story time. When we last left off, I told you there was a surprise cut potential. Now, I'm not going so far as to say this is my prediction. I haven't decided if I want to, you know, just jump all the way on board and say this guy is going to get cut, but I'm leaning that way. Riley Reiff. Now, hear me out. The offensive line is in shambles, and so it's like, he's not the best, but he's the best on our team. If you cut him, and I'm giving you the cons for it, you cut him, and then you already have a hole. You already got to bring in probably two offensive tackles. I'm thinking you draft one, you sign one, in addition to Riley Reiff. You cut him, then that's just another guy that you got to add, and you're losing the only, you know, guy on the offensive line that's been there consistently, even though he's been kind of erratic and had a down year. The flip side of that is you save a whopping $8 million. He's due to make $8 million this year. If you cut him, none of it's guaranteed, and that cap number just goes up. Now, $31 million projected cap room with some of the moves that we've made. You can add probably Brandon Pettigrew to that, maybe a Jason Jones. If you add a Riley Reiff, and then if Calvin decides to retire, you're looking at like $50 million. Now, the draft is where you win championships. But free agency, if you find the right type of guys, you know, it can be effective as well. Now, I don't know how much Cordy Glenn is expecting to get. Offensive tackle, free agent, Buffalo Bills. I'm guessing it's in the neighborhood of $8-9 million. Maybe a little bit more, though. You know, Riley Reiff, he's not worth $8 million, but he's better than anything we have. I'm just kind of throwing it out there. Riley Reiff, a potential cap casualty. You save $8 million. Again, Bob Quinn, no connection to him, no ties. It's not the guy that he drafted. It would be a business move. It would be a business decision, and it might be one that could pay dividends. It would be very risky, though. You know, if you cut this guy, now your offensive tackle situation is even murkier, but you save a ton of money. Maybe you have a contingency thing in plan in mind. It's something that I'm not willing to jump all the way over and say I'm predicting it to happen, but I am just kind of, I'm looking at it, you know. I'm looking at it, I'm examining it, and I'm saying maybe, just maybe, the Lions are bold. They look to save, you know, $8 million on a guy that's kind of mediocre, and they just completely revamp the tackle position for their squad. Now, we're going to end this thing talking about Matt Stafford. Like I told you guys, it's do or die time for Stafford. I'm really proud of the year that he had, you know, with the adversity, especially at the beginning of the year. I saw a stat that was kind of interesting. He was the only player in the NFL this year to pass over 60% for every game. And, you know, unless I read that wrong, I read it once and I was, you know, amused by it. And I kind of moved on. That's pretty good because even the lean games, when he went 1-7 and he had too many turnovers, said that he was pretty accurate. And if this is the biggest knock on Stafford, it's his accuracy and the strong arm always there, leadership, you know, ability to come back, et cetera, et cetera. Decision-making accuracy always called into question. To me, he had one of his most impressive years. But this year is do or die because, you know, it seemed like every year, even since he's been in the league, there's been a reason why we have to wait and see. Now, the first 3-4 years in the league, you always got to wait, right? Then he got injured a good chunk of year one and year two, so that kind of pushed the clock back to, like, you know, 4 years because, hey, he missed most of the year one and year two. And so the experience clock got pushed back. Then it was Linehan. Okay, got rid of Linehan. We have a new coach, Lombardi and Caldwell. So, okay, takes a while to learn their system. You know, there's always a reason why he has not been where people thought. Well, this year, to me, it's put up or shut up time. He's staring at the potential to just really break the bank. I do think the Lions are going to do everything they can to re-sign him next offseason, not letting him go into that final year without having him locked up. But how he plays is huge. He's got his guy, Jim Bob Cooter. He's got the coach. He's got the guy that he wants. You know, there's a potential that he won't have Calvin as that crutch, which I don't really believe that anymore. I really don't think it was Calvin bailing Stafford out this year, even the year before that. He wasn't just throwing it up to Calvin and he was coming down with it. And so, you know, it's potential that Calvin won't even be there to quote unquote bail him out. It's do or die time for Matt Stafford. You know, I've made plenty of excuses or reasons. You know, some people look at all reasons as excuses. I've given plenty of whatever you want to call them, excuses or reasons as to why he hasn't made that next step, that next leap. Well, he's got the coach. It's his team. He's at that prime age. You know, they retained the coordinator that he wanted. He's due to make some big money. Now it's time. And so I'm looking at Stafford. What are your expectations for Matt Stafford this upcoming season? I really feel as though it's make or break. For me, if he goes out and it's more question marks and it's more inconsistencies, I'm just going to say, you know, this is who he is. That doesn't mean we definitely walk away from him, but I'm no longer hopeful that he can turn that corner and, you know, crack that top five, you know, ever in the league. Prove me wrong, prove me otherwise. But I just wouldn't really be that believer in him anymore in terms of being one of the top quarterbacks in the league ever. On the other hand, if he goes out and he shines this year and he increases and he improves and he cracks that top 10 and he makes a statement, then I do think he has that potential. You know, certain guys are getting a lot older. They're not getting any younger. Tom Brady, you know, Aaron Rodgers is still young, unfortunately. Peyton Manning out of here. Drew Brees. You know, there's a, you know, Ben Roethlisberger, Eli Manning, Phillip Rivers. You know, it's time for Stafford to kind of say, hey, I'm moving in an upper echelon. These guys are getting a little bit older, and I'm still young enough. And, you know, a guy like Andrew Luck ready to slide in. But there's some other guys, your Jameis Winstons and your Marcus Mariotas, you know, Russell Wilson, et cetera, et cetera. Where is Stafford going to fall into that? I'm hopeful. I'm not going to give a prediction. All I'll say is this. For Mr. Matthew Stafford, it's do or die time. Put up or shut up. Either you're one of the best. There's no more excuses. There's no more, we need another year. This coordinator, that. It's time for him to prove what he is about. Guys, this has been a fun show. We had an opportunity to talk to Nolan Vassan. Like I said, really cool having him on. We're looking forward to not just him, but other guests coming on. My prior Detroit buddies, you know, Chris Lemieux, Jeremy Reiser, Alex Reno, Ryan Matthews. Maybe I'll get them on next show. As always, DetroitSportsPodcast.com. Jerry Mallory NFL on Twitter. I'll be back next Monday. I want to thank each and every one of you for listening. And until then, this has been the Hindsight 20 Podcast.